I'm 26 and considering hair transplant. I'm so confused about doing FUT or FUE. I have typical male pattern baldness. I've been suggested to do my frontal first with 3,000 grafts, while some denoting 4,000. Some are suggesting FUT, while some are saying FUE. I really don't know what to choose. I heard FUT has better results, but just scared of scarring as I want to keep my hair short. I have a few friends for whom FUE didn't last long, hence I'm a little skeptical on that.
Thank you for your question. You submitted your question with an image of the top of your scalp, and you stated you're 26 years old, and you are trying to make a decision between whether or not to do an FUT or an FUE for a hair transplant procedure, and you state that you have friends who did FUEs who did not appear to have the most optimal outcome, so you're looking for some guidance. Well, I can certainly share with you how I counsel patients like yourself in my practice when it comes to hair loss management strategies. A little bit of background: I'm a board-certified cosmetic surgeon and fellowship-trained oculofacial plastic and reconstructive surgeon. I've been in practice in Manhattan and Long Island for over 20 years. I'm also the founder of TrichoStem Hair Regeneration Centers, a system we developed to help people with male and female pattern hair loss treat hair loss non-surgically. It has become quite a significant option as an alternative to hair transplant, particularly for people who are younger. So I think that it's important to understand a couple of things, and I think it is very, very challenging when people who are in your age group deal with hair loss. In terms of hair loss, the incidence of hair loss in different decades of life for men basically is referred to as the rule of decades. So in your 20s, only 20% of men have hair loss, while as you get into your middle to later decades, your 50s and older, more than 50% have hair loss. The challenge with hair loss in your situation, in your age group, and with your degree of advanced hair loss, is what do you do to manage your hair loss before you move forward with a hair transplant? It is a common story that I get to hear in our practice when people come to me somewhere in their 30s. And they've already had one or two hair transplants in their 20s. Unfortunately, their hair loss progresses, and they only have some isolated transplants, and further, those transplants are not anywhere close to enough to provide a significant amount of coverage, and so they end up in their mid-30s and beyond not looking like they had a lot of hair, even though they underwent anywhere from 2 to 4 surgeries. The challenge is really to manage hair loss before doing surgery, and I think it's very important. It's also important to understand that hair loss is progressive, and having an early onset puts you in a more aggressive category. Basically, when it comes to this hair regeneration treatment that I mentioned earlier, we developed a system based on our experience first doing hair transplant. We were trying to help our transplant patients get a better yield of their grafts, as well as improve the healing of the donor area, which was the strip method. What we also got to see was that thinning hairs in a lot of patients became thicker. Move the clock forward over several years, now going on close to 8 years, I developed a system to address patients with male and female pattern hair loss. But further, I was also able to identify essentially through a lot of challenges and obstacles and setbacks that certain categories of patients have more aggressive hair loss than others. And so I developed a classification system, and that classification system has to do with essentially gender, age of onset, degree of hair loss, rate of progression, as well as other medical issues that are important to understand. So one of the things I would say to most of my younger patients, patients who are in their 20s, is that almost by definition, having an early onset, that it's already obviously hardwired in your DNA, but I would propose that you have also a higher DHT sensitivity, dihydrotestosterone, which is essentially one variable that is important in the progression of hair loss. So a lot of my patients who are in your age group, I counsel to consider strongly to take a DHT blocker such as finasteride. Of course, people looking on the internet are very often afraid to take finasteride, but I try to put things in context of current clinical knowledge and the fact that this drug has been around since 1997. So we try to put things in perspective and look at every patient individually, but I do routinely prescribe this drug as another tool to help slow down progression. In addition, we also do a treatment called hair regeneration. What we're doing essentially is reactivating hair that isn't currently growing, which by definition is due to androgenetic alopecia, where the thinning hair, actually the growth cycles get shorter and the resting phases get longer, which means there's fewer hairs that are actually present. In addition, we also find that thinning hairs get thicker, as well as the prolongation of the hair growth cycle. Occasionally, when we see our patients, we are essentially seeing them in a snapshot, and there's no way to know whether they're in a stable or relatively stable phase of their progression or whether they're on their way down. And so sometimes a lot of these patients who are younger, who have more advanced hair loss, their thinning hair is almost, if not certain percentages, are already at the end of a growth cycle, never to grow again, which means they can still progress before they stabilize and before we can manage maximizing their growth cycles to be as long as possible. And using a combination of a DHT blocker and injection is a way that we are trying to help them combat a very aggressive DNA program. So I would say that it is important for you to think of stabilization and management before you do surgery. I think that we have enough experience to know that a lot of people who go through surgery at a young age will later regret it because they still progress and now they're stuck with a certain look that doesn't really work that very well for them. So think about that seriously before you make this decision between FUT versus FUE. There's a mismatch between the amount of scalp that needs coverage and the amount of hair that's available in your donor area. Yes, more aggressive or more ambitious patients will undergo body hair transplant, which is a valid choice, but you should still think about how to maximize the lifespan of your existing hair for as long as possible to minimize and delay hair transplant. At least from my perspective, I think that makes more sense than just doing transplant after transplant. So I hope that was helpful. I wish you the best of luck. Thank you for your question.